But good morning to all of you. Welcome to New Hope Community Church. It is great to have you here on the second Sunday of July. Thanks for being here. What a great time we had last Sunday as we celebrated the birth of our nation, and the patriotic choir was here, and it was just a grand time. And we're looking forward for God's blessing and activity with us today. If you are visiting with us, this is your first time here, there are some visitor cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to get it, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by. And then next week through the mail, we'll send you information that tells you about New Hope Church. We promise we will not beat on your door. We will not bother you on the phone. But through the mail, send you information we hope will answer most of your questions about New Hope Church. Hope you enjoyed the little cool down yesterday. Huh? Wasn't that nice? Yeah, that was just a setup for 109 tomorrow, all right? So if any of you need a cooling station, just show up at the church. Office will open up the Murbach building. We'll turn the cooler on, all right? And you can hang out in there. I said that in the 8 o'clock service, and one of the ladies wanted to know if the TV worked. And I said yes, for DVDs, but soap operas, we can't get those, all right? So they don't show up. We do not have cable here, all right? let me highlight a few announcements. Guys back there, do we have the BFMO available at a moment's notice? Yeah, the one from Fawn. Let's watch. Fawn has an announcement she would like to make, and she is in Nevada. You'll see why, but she has an announcement she'd like to make there. We'll talk about that one in just a minute. Hey, coming around is going to be a sign-up sheet for a movie night on July the 25th. That is a Friday night. They're going to be showing in the sanctuary, not out in the parking lot, but in the sanctuary. They're going to be showing the movie God's Not Dead. It was just in the theaters about a month ago. We are going to be showing it here at the church. If you saw it once, it's worth seeing again. If you didn't see it the first time, I hardly recommend. Though it's set in a college setting, and I think college students will enjoy it, those of us who are not in college, I believe you will enjoy it as well, all right? It's not exclusively an age group thing. It's really more of a thematic thing, and it's very well done. So that will be starting in the sanctuary at 7 o'clock, but if you'd like to come and hang out a little earlier, the other buildings will be open, so you can eat indoors. But we are going to have they're going to have a taco truck here, all right? The taco guys. Now, this is not a roach coach. No roaches allowed on that coach. All right, they have been here before for another event. They do a great, great job, and really, really good. And so the sign-up sheet is not because you have to pay anything before you come. They want to be able to tell the taco boys about how many are going to be here. All right, so they are prepared, and they have enough for what we believe will show up. So put that on your calendar, Friday night, July the 25th. That is not this Friday, but that would be, I believe, the following Friday. Okay? Let's see here. Video's ready? Okay, this is a women's event coming up in the month of August, on August the 9th. To tell us about it is Fawn Boss herself.
Good morning, New Hope. Sorry I'm not there with you today, but I'm busy whooping it up over in Vegas. No, it's not what you think. I'm whooping it up with Adelaide May. Hi, baby girl. New Hope, meet Adelaide May. Adelaide, meet New Hope. I'm going to pause here so you can ooh and aah for a minute.
Aww.
Couple more. Okay, isn't she a blessing? Children are just so wonderful. This is my newest granddaughter. We're having a blast over here. She's so precious. Jesus gives the best gifts, doesn't he? But as wonderful as children are, ladies, truthfully, sometimes don't we need a day off? I'm talking to you mothers and you grandmothers and you wives and girlfriends too. We all need a day away sometimes, and we're going to have that next month on August 9th. We're having our next women's event. We've rented a theater room over at Sierra Vista Mall, and we're going to show a film. We're going to start at 9:30 in the morning, so we'll have you out in the coolest part of the day. We're going to have raffle prizes and snacks. Now, the tickets go on sale for this event next Sunday, July 20th, out here in the pavilion, before and after the 9:15 services. Now this year, our theme is BFMO. That stands for Best Friend Morning Out. We're asking you to invite your best friend to this event. Now for some of you, your best friend is sitting right in the pew next to you. We're asking you to go outside the box and invite one of your friends that doesn't go to church. We're all going to be there together as sisters and friends, but let's invite some people that don't know how much fun we have here at New Hope so they can enjoy the day with us. Now, the good news is these tickets are only $5 a piece, So you might actually even be able to get the ticket for your friend. So remember, get ready for the event on Saturday, August 9th, and the tickets go on sale next Sunday, $5 out in the pavilion. We'll see you there. Bye. Say bye. Oops, we lost our hat. Oh, we got to fix that. Say bye, Adelaide. Bye-bye. Look at all this hair. Look at all this hair. Bye.
A proud grandmother. All right, a proud, proud grandmother. So, ladies, next Sunday tickets will be available for that event. I cannot answer the question. I don't know if anybody here can. What the movie is? You don't want to say yet. It's a secret. All right. It will be PG or less. Right. Okay. All right. Good. I was asked. XXX. No. All right. Very good. All right, Fresno Grizzly tickets are available today. You can see Gene Sperling outside under the pavilion for that is for August the 1st. The price is $13, but you get two baseball games for the price of $13, all right? And it is Christian Fellowship Night on August the 1st at Grizzly Stadium. Just at the end of the week, we mailed out mid-year giving statements. We started doing this a year ago, actually 2 years ago. As you know, at the end of every year, the beginning of the next year, as a church, we must get out the giving statements to all those who contributed by a certain deadline in order to be in compliance with the law, and we like to be lawfully compliant. What we also found out over the years is that quite often we got several back because of wrong addresses or a mistake, and then we are not in compliance by the time we finally catch up to everybody. So we start doing it now, just kind of an update in the middle of the year. If you don't get yours within the next day or two, call the church office, all right? And say, hey, didn't get mine. That means either you moved or we did a typo for your address, and we want to make sure we have it right by the end of the year, all right? So if you give by check or if you put your name on an envelope, whether it's $1 or whether it's $1,000, all right, you should get a giving statement from us. Now, if you just put cash in an envelope with no name on it, there's nothing we can do about that, okay, except we put all that under Gene's name, okay? I'm just kidding on that. No, it just goes into cash contributions. But if your name is attached in any shape, form, or fashion, whether it's to the church or to any mission organizations that we support, you should get within the next day or two a statement from us. If not, please let the office know so we can make any corrections. Also, take a look at your statement to make sure it's accurate because they can make mistakes, all right, in entering them. Sometimes you can get a period in the wrong spot, and that will make a huge difference, all right? We also have, for example, we have had Joe Fish and Joe Fish. We got two Joe Fishes in our church, all right? It could be easy for somebody to make a mistake. We have Shirley Robertson and Shirley Robertson, okay? Two different people, two different families, okay? So please check them to make sure that the office has done an accurate job. Thank you. VBS volunteers, we're going to do a second VBS in a park in downtown Clovis at the corner of Sierra and Clovis Avenue for 3 days. We're going to be engaged in ministering to the children in the community of Weldon Elementary School. And if you would like to be a volunteer, you say, Tim, I cannot teach. That's okay. Can you be there to help? You can pass out food. You can help with games. You can help set up. You can help clean up at the end of each day. We're doing it for 3 days. First time to do anything like this. This was the brainchild of Jennifer Addis, our children's ministries coordinator. And we are so excited to make an impact within the city of Clovis. So thank you for your willingness to help. Take a card, put your name on it, write Summertime or Park VBS with a phone number, and Jennifer will follow up with you. Today, after the third service, is the appreciation lunch for Prison Fellowship. If you have helped out PF in any way during this past year, they would love to say thank you by serving you lunch today. Or if you have questions about the ministry of Prison Fellowship, they would love for you to come and have lunch, and they'll do their best to answer your questions today. So that will be after the third service over in the Murbach building. All right? The Believe book. This is the series that we are going to start the middle of August, okay? It's going to be a 32-week study, 2 weeks of introductory material, and then 30 weeks of covering the content of this book, all right? The first 10 lessons are going to be on the foundational truths and doctrines of the Bible. What is it that we build our eternal life on? The next 10 truths that we're going to look at are the 10 practices of the church, the body of Christ. What are the things that the Bible tells us as the body of Christ, the church, that we should be engaged in? And the last 10 weeks are going to be on the character of Christ that should be reflected in us, all right? How our life should be shaped by the life of Christ in us. What does that look like? So 10, 10, and 10. Much like the story, where it's in a book, it's the Bible. The story was the Bible in chronological order. Believe is the Bible in theological divisions, all right? So the first chapter's on God. So all the scripture verses in the first chapter are the verses found throughout the Bible about the nature and the character of God. The chapter which would be on love or compassion, it's all the verses of the Bible, all right, in a book format, like you would read a book, all right, on the subject of love. And it does that for all 30 of the subjects that are in here. So this is set up theologically rather than chronologically. And it will follow with what we are studying in those 32 weeks. These are available out on the table. When these become available for the public next year, remember, we're a beta test church. We're doing this before it's out to the public, so that's why it says on the backside, uncorrected proof. But these will be $19.95 for us. If you're paying your bills regularly, they're $10. Okay? If you might be a little behind, trying to have a tough time meeting everything, they're $5. If you just ain't meeting any of them, they're free. Okay? So in other words, if life is really tight, just take one. We want you to have one. If things are you know, you're getting by, but you can afford it, $5. If things are doing okay, then they're $10 a piece. It's on the honor system out there, and you'll find a stack of them out there after the service, okay? Now let me hit a few prayer requests. It's great, by the way, to have Andy Ajam with us here today. Thanks for coming out to see us from Tennessee. Glad you're here. You're here for a baby shower, too, today, I understand. All right, that'll be exciting. Glad I'm not a woman. No, I am. I'm glad I'm not. All right. Yeah. Yeah. I'm glad you ladies are. All right. But, you know, I prefer my showers alone rather than in company with others. Okay. Let me get to prayer requests before I end up in real trouble here. All right. The Lacefield Bombay family memorial service will be here this coming Saturday. So please be praying for them. All right. Francisco, a delightful lady who lived in Clovis for many, many years, did her service this last week. If you would be remembering her family, I know they would appreciate that so much. One of Dad's best friends, Jack Ritchie from Oklahoma, they've been boyhood friends. His wife, Mona, is under hospice care, and we're expecting to call at any moment that she has kept her appointment and is home with the Lord. So just be praying for them. Sonny Osborne, Bernice's son, also under hospice care. The good news is both of them know the Lord. Both of them know they have a room and a home ready in eternity. And just be praying for their families. The Little Fishes have arrived in Danville, Virginia. All right? So they are there. I don't think they're all unpacked yet. The Senior Fishes are with them also and will be returning soon. And then a special request, got this late last night. One of the young ladies that we honored as a graduate from Buchanan High School just a little over a month ago, her and her dad were coming back from a trip over to Morro Bay, and they were involved in an automobile accident. And Kay was flown. She was airlifted to Fresno, and she had surgery on her abdomen last night. She had fluid in her abdomen and concern about her vertebrae. They've done a CAT scan. There's a possibility that she broke her back. We will know more about that later today. She has been talkative and responsive and communicative, so please be praying for her as she goes through this recovery and whatever treatment is necessary. Her dad was transported to the Hanford Hospital. It was the closest hospital. His injuries were not as critical. They hope he will be released today to get up here. And Mom was in Japan. And as of this morning, it was uncertain whether she even knew about the accident yet because of the time changes and getting information there. So just please be remembering this family. Teddy, who's connected with our high school group, got the call, and he was there at the hospital late last night helping to be an encourager through all of this. So please be remembering to pray for Kay, just a delightful young woman. Her dad is also a doctor at Kaiser Hospital. So if you would just be remembering them, they would appreciate that so very, very much. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward as they wait on us for our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen or ladies, would you come? We have all gentlemen today. Great. Let's pray. Father, the privilege of sharing every moment of every day of life with you is a gift that you give to us. There are times that we readily receive your gift and enjoy it, and there are other times, Father, we just sort of leave it sitting on the table and we forget about it. We discover that when we forget about it, we wished we would have remembered. And so, Father, if we're in need today of confessing that far too often this past week we left you at home sitting on the table, and Father, we confess to you that we blew it. Thank you for your forgiveness and your readiness to walk with us in great fellowship today, and then again tomorrow, and again the next day. Father, we trust you with the needs of Kay. She's facing challenging times right now to be so young. Thank you for the doctors and the swift work that the nurses and the staff at the hospital and the paramedics did. We trust you for her recovery. We pray for her parents and her siblings. And Father, we trust that the love and the life of Christ will be seen through the members of New Hope, that it will give them the encouragement they need to get through these days. Father, I know you have members of your family even in Japan, and may they gather around Mom when she finds out the news. Lord, we trust you with our Uncle Al in Oklahoma, who's in intensive care today, and you know his needs. Father, we trust you for the needs of Mona and Sonny and for their families. Your word tells us that when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we have nothing to fear. And so both as friends and family, may we walk with those that we love fearlessly, knowing that what lies ahead is better than what we're leaving behind. Thank you for the privilege of giving and sharing today, Father. May we give to you as an expression of your love for us and our confidence in that love in our own lives. We commit all this to you in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen. For those of you who might be joining us today, we're right in the middle of a sermon series that we've called 40 Days to a Healthier You. We're spending some time looking at our spiritual and our physical, our mental, our emotional, our financial, however you can apply health to your life. That is the broad spectrum of what we are looking at. How can we be healthier a week from now, a month from now, a year from now than we are right now? And it doesn't mean that we will ever get to a place of perfect health in any of those areas. We know that some people battle illnesses that are going to be theirs all the way to the grave. We know that there are going to be some circumstances. What do we consider being healthy financially? That's a different evaluation for everybody, but all of us can say, here's where we are. Can I be healthier? In terms of our mental and our emotional stability, where are we right now, and what can we allow God to do in us that we are healthier? What are decisions and choices that we can make? And where we started at last week, which is our third point, all right, the third part in this six-part series. But remember, there was 2A and 2B. Last week there was 3A, and today is 3B, all right? We're wrapping up what we started last week. And last week we were looking at setting goals by faith. All right, setting goals by faith that provide this environment where you and I can be healthier. Jonathan Edwards, he was born in the 1700s. He was an 18th century philosopher and revivalist. He was one of the fathers of the Great Awakening in this country. And my prayer would be, God, find another Jonathan Edwards in this 21st century that might be able to light a spark in this generation that was needed in the 17th century. He sat down at age 17. He was far mature beyond his years. And at age 17, and by the way, just in case you don't know who Jonathan Edwards was, if you Google him, you'll find out his famous message was Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. An incredible message, powerful. He also was a PhD. He also was the first president of Princeton University, okay? So this was no slouch, all right? This is a brilliant, brilliant man. And at age 17, he sat down and he wrote out 21 goals, 21 resolutions by which he believed God wanted to live his life through him. And throughout Edward's entire lifetime, he added more to the list so that by the time that he died, he had 70 goals and resolutions he wanted to make sure were being obtained in his life. And at the top of the list, he wrote these words, "Being sensible that I am unable to do anything without God's intervention, I humbly entreat Him by His grace to strengthen me to keep these resolutions and these goals. I trust that God will help me remember to read them at least once a week." Edwards didn't casually make goals or resolutions with an expectation like we often do of breaking them in just a matter of weeks. Each week, he would do a personal check and he would ask others, "How am I doing in this area?" He regularly summed up his progress and he sought God's strength for the next step. Christ calls us to this kind of commitment to being shaped and formed into the image of Christ. As Carlos sang that particular song in dedication to his grandmother, the words to that song fit perfectly with Jonathan Edwards' life. It is the way that he came to that type of maturity. And I pray that kind of maturity will happen in us as well. Last week, we looked at five important truths about goal setting. Let me just highlight those for you. And then I told you this week, we would look at five of the characteristics of good, godly goals that God wants to bless. So let me highlight the five principles to goal setting. Number one, goal setting is a spiritual discipline. Goal setting is a spiritual discipline. If you weren't here last week, go back. It's on audio. It's on video. Listen to it and look at the scriptural support that was there for goal setting being a spiritual discipline, just like prayer, just like giving, just like the study of God's Word. Goal setting with God in mind is a spiritual discipline. Number two, goals that have been used as a spiritual discipline will focus my energy and my efforts. Good, godly goals, instead of us just being scattered and never accomplishing anything, goals give us focus. Number three, goals are intended to stretch our faith. In other words, if it's really easy to do, it probably isn't a great goal. All right? If it's something that you can just do naturally, probably not a great goal. That's why by faith, we need to establish these goals so that it stretches our faith. God, number four, God will use goals to build our character. And number five, anybody remember, goals give us hope. Very good. One person remembers. Way to go. All right? Goals give us hope that when we're walking through the valleys, it is hope that brings us out to the mountaintops on the other end. All right? Galatians chapter 3, verse 3, Paul said this, "Are you so foolish that after beginning with the Spirit, you are going to try to attain your goal by human effort?" Paul reminds us that if we have prayed and sought God's leadership in the establishment of good and godly goals in our lives, we must remember through the entire journey, it is going to be God who enables us to see those goals reached and obtained in our lives. Don't start out spiritual and end up trying to do it on our own. And that's what he said. To do that is absolutely foolish. It's important to realize that not every goal is a good goal. You can have some goals, and just setting goals doesn't mean that's a good thing. You can set goals that aren't good, and also you can have some good goals that aren't godly. And in the context of what we are talking about, we want it to accomplish both good and godly. And I would suggest to you, if we emphasize the godly, it will be good. If you emphasize the good, it may not be godly, but if you emphasize the godly, it will be good. Not every goal is a goal that gets God's blessings. I am making an assumption here, so you all tell me if my assumption is valid. I am assuming that we obviously want God's blessings on our goals. Is that a pretty good assumption? For most of you, at least nod. Okay? All right? All right. It seems to be a reasonable assumption. So we need to set good godly goals. Five things. What kind of goals will God bless in our lives? Number one, godly goals, the kind of goals that God blesses, are the goals that will bring glory to God. That seems obvious, but let me say it this way. The goals that God blesses are those that will bring glory to Him. 1 Corinthians 10:31 says it this way. Whether you eat or whatever you drink or whatever you do. Let's pause right there. He's talking about what you eat. He's talking about what you drink. And then what does he leave out? Nothing. That is absolutely right. You guys are paying attention. Because it says next, whatever you do, what is excluded from that? Nothing. Whatever you do, whether it's cleaning a toilet, whether it's building a bridge, whether it's painting a picture, whether it's playing beautifully on a piano, whether it's on vacation or in the day of employment, whatever it is, whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. The Bible makes it pretty clear. Everything you do should have some reflection of God in it. In other words, it ought to be done for the right reason. If you've been here very long, you've heard this story. You'd say, Tim, find some original material. I try. But this is absolutely true. This is when it was driven home to me in a way I've never forgotten. I was about 22 years old. I was sales manager at Fresno Bible House, and we had just hired a new employee. He was a young man who worked at a Christian college in town at the time, and he wanted to work in the book and Bible department. But we did not have a position in the book and Bible department. The only opening we had was to help out in our shipping and receiving and to do janitorial duties every morning before the store opened. I told him, this is all that we have. I would love to hire him. Great guy. I'd love for him to work there. And as soon as something opened up out on the floor, I'd be happy to move him out there. He said, Tim, I'll take it. I just really want to work here. I said, great. That first Saturday morning that he started, and Saturdays were my morning to be there extra early to have the store open for everybody else to get there and get the store ready for customers at 9:30. And so he was already there waiting to go to work the very first morning. He was there before I was, and I opened the door. I let him in. We had already shown him what he was to do, and I'm down the hallway taking care of some things. As I come back down by the women's and then the men's restroom, I hear singing in the men's bathroom. I open up the door. And here he is on his knees in front of the urinal, scrubbing the urinal, and he's singing, oh, how I love Jesus. And he's just singing away. And I looked at him and I said, hey, what are you doing? He said, I am cleaning this thing as if Jesus were going to use it today. And that is a true story. And I have never, ever forgotten. And I thought, wow, there is a lesson for me, humbly on his knees in front of maybe the dirtiest thing on the face of the earth. And he says, I am doing this as if I'm doing this for Christ. That is a goal that God loves to bless. It's when we have an attitude like that. You see, this says, whether we eat, do it to the glory of God. Friday night, we went to dinner with Pops for his 89th birthday, huh? Last Friday, 89. Woo! We went to Black Angus, and they brought out the menu. And I got to be honest, my first thought was, to the glory of God, I'm going to eat this prime rib. That was not my first thought. My first thought was, oh my goodness, would you look at that dessert menu? I'm thinking at that moment about what smells and tastes and probably is the most cow-related. But would I be healthier all the way around if I ask a question, God, how can I honor you? Not that I think God gives a rip necessarily what I eat, but I think he might care how much of it I ate. Do you know the Bible does say gluttony is a what? That's pretty specific, isn't it? I got a sneaking suspicion I have been gluttonous in the past. In fact, I can really identify the last time I was really, really gluttonous. I was in the state of Montana at the steakhouse, and I ordered a 27-ounce ribeye. Yeah. The owner raises his own steers, and he butchers them, and they're hanging right there, man. It's fresh cut, right? It was awesome. And you know what? For about 13 ounces, I did not sin. After that, I did. And that wasn't wise. It wasn't wise. There's a bigger issue than here. This. It's not the matter of what you do in life. The matter is, can what I do be done to the glory of God? Can I do it with the right attitude and the right motivation? And what is that right attitude? I suggest to you, the right attitude in all situations is gratitude, is thankfulness. I want to bring honor to Christ. We could take the garbage out and say, Lord, while I'm taking this garbage out, I'm going to talk to you while I'm dumping the garbage. You just keep this running conversation going in your mind, practicing the presence of God at all times, taking garbage out or cleaning a urinal, and anything can be done for the glory of God. What kind of goal brings glory to God? I would suggest to you, any goal that causes us to love Jesus more is a goal that will bring glory to God. So as we set goals, a great question is this goal going to enable me to have a bigger heart for God? Number two, any goal that causes me to be more grateful to God is a good goal. Number three, any goal that causes me to want to serve God is a good goal. Next, any goal that causes me to be drawn deeper into a relationship with Him is a good goal. Any goal that causes me to want to brag on God to other people, to share my testimony and witness and say, hey, look what God is doing for me. That's a godly goal. That gives us a lot of room. Any goal that's going to cause us to love Christ more as we fulfill it and cause us to obey His word more, to trust Him daily more, that is a good goal that He wants to bless. So you want to bring glory to God by loving and trusting and serving and obeying Him. The Bible says it this way in 2 Corinthians 5:9. We make it our goal to please Him, whether we are at home in this body, notice the word, whether we are home in this body or whether we are away from it. How's the only way we get away from this body? Yeah, we die, all right? The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. To be present in this body is for the Lord to be present in us. So whether on earth or in heaven, make it our goal to please Him. And how does the Bible say we please God? By faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please the Lord. Number two, okay, number two. Number one, bring glory to God. Number two, godly goals, the kind God blesses, are motivated by love. Motivated by love. This is very important because God is far more interested in why we do what we do than what we actually do. He's more interested in our heart than our actions. He wants to know, why do you do what you do? Why did you set this goal? You see, God, I believe, is not going to bless a goal that's motivated by fear. God says, I have not given to you a spirit of fear or timidity, but I've given to you a spirit of a sound mind, Jesus Christ. God is not going to bless a goal that's motivated by guilt, okay? How many of you have ever gone on a diet because you felt guilty? Okay, that's a half a hand, okay? But yeah. And how many of you have ever been guilted into doing something at church because the preacher made you feel guilty? Come on, it's okay to be honest. I know it was your previous church. Not. We do. We motivate by guilt, and we shouldn't. It's wrong. It's not a good way to do it. God is not going to bless a goal that is motivated by pride. I just want six-pack abs so the women will touch my chest. No. I just want to lose this weight so I look really good in the bathing suit. That's pride. Some people set goals by peer pressure. Hey, everybody else is doing it. I need to do this. I need to upgrade because my neighbors are upgrading. Some goals are motivated by jealousy and envy. God isn't going to bless that kind of goal when you say, I want this because they have it. Some goals are set because of materialism. I just want more. It's greed. God isn't going to bless a materialistic goal. I just want more. There's no reason God would bless that. Jealousy, pride, fear, guilt, anger, poor motivation for our goals. God blesses goals that are motivated by love. And the Bible tells us what kind of love. 1 Corinthians 6:14 says this, everything you do must be done with love. What is left out? Nothing. Everything you do must be motivated by love. So that means the revenge goal that you've set. Not much love in that goal, is there? See, love needs to be the motivation. That's the number one lesson in life. God is love. God put us on this earth to learn and to be transformed into His image. And that means God is concerned about our love. If we don't learn and appropriate love, it doesn't matter what we accomplish or what we acquire or what we do or what we experience, because God has put us here to learn to love Him with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, with all of our strength, and in loving Him, to learn to love our neighbor in the same way we can learn to love ourselves. Learn to love God, learn to love others. That is the big lesson of life. So if you're not learning love in your goals, God is not going to bless them. Why do you do what you do is more important than just what you do. And this verse tells us there are two kinds of love that motivate us to set goals. Our love for the Lord Jesus Christ and our love for other people. When we use these two motives to help us set our goals. Lord, I want to get in shape because I want to offer to you the healthiest body I can. I want to get in better shape because I want to love my family and I want to last and not die prematurely. I want to get in shape because of my love for Him and my love for others. If we're doing it for Him and we're doing it for others, God loves to bless it. But if we're doing it just to look sexier, quite frankly, some of us are just out of luck. We've got to have a better goal and one that God can bless. The first is my love for the Lord. The Bible says it like this in Galatians 2:20. Galatians 2:20 starts out like this: I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, not I, but Christ lives in me. But let's get to the second part of that verse, and some of you may know it. Can you quote it with me? The life I live in the body. Did you overlook that in all the other times you've quoted that verse? The life I live in the body. The life I live in the flesh. I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself to me. Jesus Christ gave Himself on the cross. He loves us. He died for us. How could we not love Him back when He made such a sacrificial gift to every one of us? I love Jesus with all of my heart. And even if He never did anything else except die on the cross for me, that death paid the debt of all my sins. Because He paid that debt and because I accepted the gift of His forgiveness, I now have a home in heaven. Even if Jesus Christ did not get raised from the dead so that He could come live in my life between now and the time that I die, just the gift of a home in heaven when I die ought to be worth my investment in a good purpose and a good goal for the rest of the days on the face of this earth. But the other motivation is our love for other people. The Bible says, 1 John 4:12, no one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and His love is made complete in us. If you set goals in your life without love, then people become projects. We will use people to get to our goals and then we miss the whole point, because the whole point is learning how to love. As Shelley sat by the bedside of her dad when he had had a heart attack and was about ready for surgery to make sure that his heart was right with God. Huge step of forgiveness. She did it because God loved her and because God wanted her by Him to love her father. The anger, the frustration, didn't matter. Love that is sacrificial, that you don't know how others will respond when you offer it, is what God is talking about in these goals. 1 Corinthians 14:1 says, let love be your highest goal. Another translation says, pursue love. Go after love as if your life depended on it. Godly goals bring glory to God and are motivated by love. Number three, godly goals fulfill God's purposes for our life. If we want to have a goal that God is going to bless, we need to set a goal that fulfills His purposes for our lives. See, God says, I have plans for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. And if you've ever done much study in the Bible, you know that God has some goals and purposes for every one of our lives. And maybe the best author who's ever put it together in a very succinct form is the pastor at Saddleback, Rick Warren, when he wrote his book, The Purpose-Driven Life. And in that particular book, he captures five purposes that God has for every single one of us. Number one, let me just highlight this quickly. Number one, we were planned for God's pleasure. So our first purpose is to offer real worship. And we've talked about that recently. Present our bodies as living sacrifices, wholly acceptable to God, which is our reasonable act of worship. Yeah. Number two, we were formed for God's family. So our second purpose is to enjoy real fellowship. People who want to tell us, I don't need to go to church to be a Christian, they are right. The thief on the cross didn't have to go to church to be a Christian. I might suggest to you, he didn't have time to go to church since he became a Christian, all right? He just went right to heaven. But here's the deal. God said, we are a body. He said, don't forsake the assembling of yourself together. Why? Because God says we are to be seen by the world as those who are united just as God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit are one. We as members of His body and His family, we are to be one. The world will recognize the love of God in the exchange of relationships. If I lost my hand and it lived over in Oakhurst, get my directions here, okay? Prather, okay? If my hand lived at Prather, I wouldn't have much fellowship with my hand on a daily basis, would I? And that's kind of the way it is when we want to say, hey, I can do this all by myself. No, we were formed for God's family. We were to enjoy real fellowship. Number three, we were created to become like Christ. So our third purpose is to learn real discipleship. Number four, we were shaped for serving God, so our fourth purpose is to practice real ministry. Number five, we were made for mission in life, so our fifth purpose is to live out real evangelism. We are not just to get our home in heaven and not be concerned about anybody else. We are to love others. The thing about God's purpose is these are eternal purposes. They're not temporary. They are lasting. They're eternal, and that makes a huge difference in our perspective. Remember, if you think this life is all there is, then you will only set short-term goals. If you think this is all there is, if you think the grave is the final destination of your life, then folks, get out of church, live like hell, and don't worry about it. That's the advice I'm giving you. If that's what you believe. Because if you can live like hell here, you don't have to worry about hell later. But I tell you what, that's a pretty high-risk game to play. That's a very high-risk game. Play. Some people say I only go around once in life, so we better do it with gusto, right? Wrong. We may go around once in this life, but we need to do it with God and not gusto. The truth is, we're going to face God. And when we do, act two of our life starts. So you better set goals that have more impact in the second part of your life after death than in the first part of our life on earth. If you only think this is all there is, you can say, get all you can, enjoy all you can, use other people all you can, and live for yourself and just make the most of what you've got now, because that's all there is. But if life is preparation for eternity, if the choices we make in this life determine eternal destiny, then we've got to view our goals very, very differently. I guess what I'm saying is this, when we pray, do we pray to use God for our purposes, or do we pray to align our choices with God's purposes? You say, God, you made me. You have a plan for my life. What do you want me to do with my life? How can I serve you so I can enjoy eternity forever? Let God use us for His purposes. The Bible says it this way in Romans 6:13. Do not use any part of yourself to sin. One translation says, do not use the parts of your body for sin or to be used for wicked purposes. Instead, give yourself to God. Surrender your whole being to Him to be used for righteous purposes. Paul did this. He says, I run straight towards the goal with a purpose in every step that I take. Paul was a purpose-driven runner. He said, I'm going through life and I'm running towards the goal that God has for me. I want to bring pleasure to God. I want to follow Him. I want to do what God desires to do in my life, and I refuse to be distracted. How easily are we distracted in life today from those eternal goals that God would love to accomplish? The Bible often compares life to a race. In a race, you don't get to set the finish line. The finish line has already been predetermined. And God has predetermined your finish line. The Bible says it this way. It is appointed unto man and woman once to die. There is your finish line at your death. It's there. You can't change it. Big, We make progress one step at a time towards the finish line. It's the way we go towards our goals, one step at a time. It's the same way we eat an elephant, one bite at a time. You set a big goal and then you go after it, making progress with purpose in every step. There may be missteps. We may fall down, but the good news is life is not a 50-yard sprint. This is a marathon. We may fall down, but we can get back up. Paul said it in one place like this: I have been knocked down, but I'm not knocked out. I can get up and I can keep pressing to the finish line. The year was 1980. Bill Broadhurst, who hadn't run in any race since his high school days, decided to begin training for a marathon. It was known as the Pepsi Challenge 10K. How far is a 10K? Six?
6.2.
Okay. Why don't they just say 6.2? 10K, I don't. What's a 12J? Okay. This was in Omaha, Nebraska. He sent his application. He wasn't sure they would accept him as a participant, but soon the approval came and he was a designated part of the running pack. His major reason for wanting to be in the race was so he could run with Bill Rogers, a nationally known runner who was competing in this challenge. And Broadhurst wanted to be able to tell others, "I ran beside the great Bill Rogers." The reason Broadhurst had not run in a race since his high school days was that he had been cruelly struck down in the prime of his life with an aneurysm that caused doctors to question whether he would ever walk again, let alone run. But with dogged determination that only a few may understand, Mr. Broadhurst looked at the impossible and took on the challenge. He did learn to walk again, but always with a need to drag his leg. He would pull the foot as he progressed. And he ran the same way that he walked. At the beginning of the race, Broadhurst joined the other runners as the gun fired and hundreds of competitors trotted off, and Bill slowly followed. For a while, he could see them in the distance. The crowds cheered him for a time, and then the crowds gradually disappeared, and Bill Broadhurst ran on alone toward the halfway point. Before he got to the halfway point, all the other runners had passed him, going back to the finish line. He got to the halfway marker, and nobody was there, but he touched the post. He rounded it, and he headed for home. Turning to make his way back to the final marker, he found that he was the forgotten man. Police officers stayed with him for a while, but then they got calls to other duties. Children came out along the way and imitated him painfully as he ran on. The markers that had been laid out on the course had now been taken down, but Broadhurst trudged to the goal. Finally, it was in sight. Although the crowds had disappeared, and although that nothing was left except for the line painted on the street as the finish point, Bill Broadhurst struggled to the end with no one to watch his victory. He had overcome personal obstacles, and he crossed the line several hours after the race had begun. As he crossed the line and turned to go towards his car, out of the alley came the sound of applause and cheering as several of the other runners had waited there for him to finish. And leading the pack was Bill Rogers, who had won the event. Rushing forward, Bill Rogers put Broadhurst on his shoulders and carried him for a distance, and then he set him down. He took the medal off his neck and he put it around Broadhurst's neck and he said, "You are the real winner of this event." He finished. It wasn't fast. But he finished. It is what Paul said in 2 Timothy 4:7, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. Now there is in store for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day, and not only to me, but also to those who have longed for his appearing." As you and I labor through this life, and as we walk through the valleys, even that last one, the valley of the shadow of death, folks, we will not be alone. The Lord Jesus says, "I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will not abandon you. I will be with you." And you know what, folks? In the alleyways of heaven are the saints of history past cheering us on to our final finish line. Do we have the ears of faith to hear them as they cheer us on? When it's my time to lay in a hospice bed, can I hear by faith the cheers of those who've gone before me saying, "It is okay, it is better. It is better when you get here." They did for him. I trust they will for us. Number four, godly goals are set by faith. By faith. If we want God's blessing on our goals, they must be faith-based goals. And not to be something that you and I can do easily, because then that's just a to-do list. Okay, that's just a to-do list. But what is something that is going to be difficult for me to do? Cleaning urinals. Singing, "Oh, How I Love Jesus." It's not the cleaning of urinals, it's my goal, but it's doing anything to the glory of God. That's my goal. Ruth Tucker tells the story of Carrie Malcolm, who served for 15 years as a missionary in the Philippines. Carrie was a missionary kid who grew up in China. As a teenager, she was confined for a time during World War II in an internment camp, and there she discovered a deep truth that changed her life. In the camp, she was known as Number 16. No name, no identity, just a number. One of many other Westerners who sought self-identity and comfort behind the walls and the electric fence that separated them from the outside free world. There were other MKs in the same predicament, and often they managed to get together on the yard for a few minutes of prayer, and their prayer was always the same, a prayer for freedom. But as time passed, Carrie began to feel uneasy about these times of prayer. Freedom was becoming the ultimate goal in her life, and God seemed to become less and less important. Except for His answer to their prayers for freedom, God was unimportant. She began to pray and search the Bible. Carrie came to a new outlook on life. She no longer desired to join the others in their prayers for freedom. It was only then that Carrie was able to pray the prayer, she said, that changed her life forever. She said, "Lord, I am willing to stay in this prison for the rest of my life if only I may know You more." At that moment, Carrie was free. Godly goals are to bring glory to God. They're to be motivated by love. They're to fulfill His purpose, and they're to be set by faith. And last of all, they are achieved with God's power. They're not achieved by our own power. They're achieved by God. I found out when I Googled self-help books, there are almost 87,000 published self-help books. That's a lot of knowledge out there, all right? And some of them have very good suggestions and very good ideas in there. But I'm going to tell you what, there's not a one of them contained the two things that we need that's only found in this book. The two things we need most to accomplish goals that God blesses. And one is, you and I must rely on God's strength and not our own. And number two, we must do this together. God's church, God's family. We need accountability with each other for those goals to be accomplished in our life. Jonathan Edwards said he got that to accomplish the resolutions of his life. Christ, church, sounds a little bit like small groups, doesn't it? A little like small groups. By the way, brief commercial. Seniors luncheon in August. I'm going to be your speaker, okay? I paid her for that, all right? Nobody else joined her, but that's all right. Here's why. I'm going to launch the Judy card. I briefly talked about this a couple of weeks ago, a woman in our church who died alone. It troubled me dearly. There's going to be a card we're going to make available to hope. And not only will we talk about Judy's card, but we're going to talk about other things that prepare us and others around us for those last moments of our life so that we're not having to make important decisions at a very emotional time. And so that's going to be kind of the thrust of what we're going to do that week. Why? Because we need each other. We need God's strength, and then we need accountability with each other to make sure that we stay abiding in God's strength. The Daniel Plan, I think there's one or two books of these left here. You can get them at Majesty. You can get them at Costco. You can get them elsewhere. But this is not a diet book, folks. This is a lifestyle change. And it talks about the things we've been talking about the last 4 weeks, as well as it talks about how do you get healthier physically. And a couple of Bible study groups, small groups are doing it. I'm throwing this out now to all small groups. You don't need to do the plan, but how about appointing a health champion in every one of your small groups? Whether you guys all do the Daniel Plan or not, how about appointing somebody as a health champion? What this may do just a little bit, it might change all the desserts a bit. Okay? You may have to have some health. And you know what? It may not be that you change it to dessert, but remember that 26-ounce ribeye? It was good for 13 ounces. Then it became sin. So it might be one slice, okay? Instead of multiple slices. And I probably need to talk about this at the senior luncheon. Because their dessert plates are this big and their entree plates are this big, okay? Anyway, and I know I'm meddling, but hey, guys, healthy. being healthier in all ways than we have before? Are there choices that we can make? Let me wrap this up. Three concluding verses. Proverbs 16:9 says, "We plan the way we want to live, but only God makes us able to live it." We plan, but we must trust the power of God. Number two, the Bible says in Zechariah 4:6, "You will not succeed by your own strength or your own power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord." The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek His will in what? All you do. What's left out, folks? Nothing. So that means your finances, that means your sex life, that means your health, that means your career, that means your retirement, that means your young, your youthfulness, that means your old age. In all of your ways, acknowledge Him. And what will He do? He will provide direction to your path. He'll bring your goals to completion. So many of you are still tired all the time that you live on Red Bull and Starbucks. You know what? If you will follow God's plan, you're not going to need to depend upon Red Bull and Starbucks. Trust the Lord with all of your heart and then get a spiritual partnership in your life so that you can do life together. Let me suggest to you a new goal. I want to challenge you for the glory of God to consider what might happen in your life if you would believe that you could be, at the end of this year, 5.5 months from now, healthier than you were 10 years ago in your personal life, in your physical life, in your spiritual life, in your mental and emotional life, because you did it God's way, with God's power, together with God's people. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for this church family. You have blessed me with the privilege of walking through life for 22 years at this church. And I am so blessed. Thank you for the joy of sharing life with them. I think together I can say that we love you and that we love each other most of the time. We want to give to you, Father, all of our lives. I trust you will enable us to take the time to sit down and to make some faith-based, faith-challenge goals under your leadership. This may require some changes in the way in which I handle my money. This may require some changes in the way in which I handle my health. This may change some way in which I eat and I rest. This may make some differences in priorities, like my hobbies versus spiritual disciplines. But Father, I pray that this message of a healthier me for the glory of you will not just be heard, but Father, it will be done. I pray this in your name.